Just a few minutes. Just one, just a few minutes. And let me say this, as you look at Hebrews chapter 1. The leadership, we are very, very pleased with the attendance. The upward tick in the attendance of Bible class. Amen. We've been seeing significant participation in the Bible class since we switched the service times around. We're just delighted in the effort you put forth. You still get out at the same time, amen. Just we lift the services. We still get out at the same time. We don't have something come up. We still get out at the same time, amen. We have baptism, that's why you push it behind. We love to be pushed behind for that reason, amen. When we have 50 people come forward to make confessions, I would love to see that happen. I worry about the time, amen. But are those things happening, you still get out at the same time. So don't deprive yourself of the opportunity to get to know more about God's Word, to study God's Word more in depth, to be able to sit in on the class where you have an opportunity to ask questions. If I'm up to preach this part of the worship service, it's not a good time to ask me a question, amen. I can ask you a question afterwards, but in Bible class, if I'm up to teach it, then ask me all the questions you want to ask. Ask Brother Ty, Brother Fred, Brother Sam, Brother Perry, all those sisters, you know, younger people. Ask them questions, amen. That's the opportunity that you're going to get to grow, to have interaction with teachers, to ask questions about something you may have discussed with someone, something that's on your mind. I just want you to help you be better prepared. Because we're trying to get to heaven. That's all we're trying to do, right? Sometimes it happens. They say, peel back the onion, Greg. You start to peel back the onion. It just comes down to one thing. We're trying to get to heaven. And we want to make and afford your opportunity. We don't want to be a stumbling block or hindrance to one another. And we can have disagreements and things like that, but at the end of the day, I still love you. You still got to love me, amen? Because we want to go to heaven. And nothing. And I love all y'all. I'm going to say this. None of y'all are going to keep me in heaven.
I know that's right, bro.
I hope you feel the same way about both issues. Amen. None of you are going to keep me in heaven. You're not begging God. Amen. I'm not begging God. Let's love one another. Let's work together. Amen. Amen. Well, please don't get on with the sermon. I got to go. Get on with the sermon. Hebrews chapter 1. Verse 1. I don't know why Brother Gilfay, they want to, Brother Jones, give their own scripture. I guess they want me to preach in Hebrews chapter 4. I can do that too. But this happens to everybody, so. Oh, preacher, amen, Brother Jones. Brother Jones, just keep living. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1, God was under times and God was not. In times past, spoken to the Father by the prophet. Past these last days, spoken to us by his Son, whom he have appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds. Who being the brightness of his image, of his glory, and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. Being made so much better than the angels as he had by inheritance obtained him once from the name and name. But to which of the angels said he in time, thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee, and again, I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. And again, when he bring in the first begotten into the world, he said, and let all the angels of God worship him. And of the angels, he said, who made his angels spirits and his ministers a flame of fire? But to the Son, he said, thy throne, O God, is forever and ever, a scepter of righteousness is the scepter of thy kingdom. Thou hast loved righteousness and hated iniquity. Therefore, God, even thy God, have anointed thee with all gladness above thy fellows. And thou, Lord, in the beginning hast laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the works of thine hands. They shall perish, but thou remainest, and they all shall wax old as doth a garment. And as a vessel shall thou fold them up, and they shall be changed, but thou art the same, and thy years shall not fail. But which of the angels said he at any time, sit on my right hand, until I make thine enemies thy footstool? Are they not all ministers of spirits sent forth to minister to them who shall be heirs of salvation? This has become routine. Picture this with me, amen. Every few months, at least within a year's time, consistently, you read it in the news, you see it in the newspapers, You see it online. You hear people talking about it. But there are lines of people. They're lined up outside the Apple store. Y'all know what the Apple store is, right? That's not the Apple market, amen? I'm talking about the Apple store. That's where you buy what?
Apple.
Who said Apple? You buy Apple computers, amen? Apple computers and iPods and iPads and all of those eyes, amen? Usually within a year's time, we read about it, we talk about it, we hear conversations about it, we're bombarded with marketing, amen, advertising, about people who have camped out. Some people had to beat them with a stick to get them to come to church. They'll camp out in front of the Apple store, amen. They'll camp out in front of the Apple store for days at a time. Wish I had that kind of money where I could just camp out Brother Hubbard in front of the Apple store for days at a time and not have to work and pay bills, amen. But they're camped out all night in all kinds of weather. They're breathlessly awaiting the arrival of the newest iPhone. And when it's marketed to us, it's said to be the latest and the greatest. But how soon people have forgotten, amen, if you can picture this, how soon have people forgotten the same thing was said on a few months earlier about the one that they stood in line for hours to possess. Here they are, in line for hours. Because this is the latest and the greatest thing. This is better than what was offered before. But wasn't that same thing said about 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 months before? And people stood in line, breathlessly anticipating in all kinds of weather, whether it's hot, whether it's cold, day and night, in the rain, with the little tents and chairs and things, waiting to get this that has been marketed to them by Apple. And Apple, of course, is going to say, hey, this is better. Mankind is always looking for what they believe or what they are told to believe is better. Whether it is true or not, that does not matter. But they're always looking for something that they believe or told to believe is better. They have got to have the latest because it's better to have it. Now, if that's your cup of tea and you don't go and do all that, that's on you. That's fine. That's not me. I do believe in seeking what is better. I do believe in taking personal responsibility and trying to become better. But when I'm talking about something that's better, I want to talk to you in just a few minutes this morning from the subject. If you want to go after something better, let me just drop this with you. Let me make a compelling argument this morning that if you want to pursue that which is truly better, it's better to have Jesus.
Amen.
It's better to have Jesus. The world, the religious world, is full of things that is offering, and every time you look around, something else is coming along the pipe saying it's better. We're going to offer you a better way to get to heaven. We're going to offer you a better covenant, a better promise. All these things are said to be better. But if you really want what's better this morning, what's truly best, at the end of the day, be reminded that it's better to have Jesus. Because when it's all said and done, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. In the name of Jesus Christ, he's been given a name that's above all name, a name that's been exalted above all name. He has been given the preeminence, Ephesians chapter 1. This thing is all about Jesus. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. It was not Muhammad. It was not the Pope. It was not Charles Cash Russell. It was not Mary Baker Eve. It was not none of these people. See, Charles Mason, it was not none of these people. For God so loved the world that he gave his son. It was not James, Joseph Smith. It was not Brigham Young, amen. For God so loved the world that he gave his son. So if you want to seek and you want to make heaven your home, let me compel you to understand and to buy into, it's better to have Jesus. Why is it better to have Jesus? Five brief reasons here why it's better to have Jesus, and this lesson is yours to do with what you please, amen? God's word is not going to come back void. It's going to accomplish that for which it was sent out for. And I simply want to make a compelling argument this morning from God's word. Let God be true, and every man a liar. Mm-hmm. From God's word, let me make this compelling argument this morning that it's better to have Jesus. Number one, it's better to have Jesus because he is so much better than the angels. Now, people, you ever get those things that see on your text, it'd be a picture of something in the clouds that look like an angel? somebody passed by a window and some image is up there and people flock to. So people have a tendency to want to worship angels. Angels are our fellow servants, first of all, amen. So we're not commanded, recommended, encouraged, or anything else to worship angels. But just in case that you are inclined this morning to want to worship angels, let me tell you something. Jesus is better than the angels. What are you talking about, preacher? It says it right here in our text. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1. God, who is sundry times and in divers manners, spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophet, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the world, who being the brightness of his glory and express image of his person, upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself. Let me remind you, there has been no angel that has shed blood for you. It says, when he had by himself purged our sins were purged by his blood. No angel, no image, amen, has shed blood for you. Amen. It's better to have Jesus. After he had purged our sins, he sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. That spot is reserved for Jesus, not for an angel, amen. And then it even says here, just to make sure we understand, being so much better than verse 4, than who? Being made so much better than the angels, and he had by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. At the name of Jesus Christ, every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess. Neither is there salvation in Acts 4:12. But there's not other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. His name is superior to the name of angels. He is superior to the name of angels. Angels worship him.
That's right.
Amen. He does not worship angels. We worship him. We do not worship angels. I'm reminded in the Bible of several occasions where someone bowed down to an angel and the angel said, get up. I'm your fellow servant. It's better to have Jesus because he is so much better than the angels. Number two, it is better to have Jesus because he is so much better than Moses. You know, there are still people today who are running around holding up Moses' name in higher regard than the name of Jesus Christ. But man, help you to see that it's better to have Jesus because he is so much better than Moses. Moses was a good man in his own right. In Matthew chapter 17, remember Jesus, Moses, and Elijah up on the mount. Moses was a good man. Moses was a great law giver. Amen. But the law that he gave was centered around the coming of Jesus Christ. So I'm not going to try to downplay Moses, but I'm just trying to put comes to Jesus. It's better to have Jesus in one church because Jesus is so much better than Moses. And Moses was a good man. Hebrews chapter 3. Hebrews chapter 3, if you will look there briefly. Hebrews chapter 3. Start at verse number 1. Hebrews chapter 3, verse number 1, it says, "Wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our profession, Christ Jesus, who was faithful to him that appointed him, as also Moses was faithful in all his house." Moses had a purpose. Moses was to lead God's people to a certain point. Moses was to bring God's people out of Egyptian bondage after 432 years of captivity. Moses was to do this. But then he prophesied about Jesus. And the Bible speaks about the Lord thy God shall raise up a prophet from amongst your brethren like unto me, Moses says, him shall ye hear. Moses says, it's not about me. It's better to have Jesus, church, because he's so much better than Moses. Amen. Hebrews chapter 3, verse number 3, it says, "For this man was counted worthy of more glory than Moses." Moses has his proper place, amen. Moses at no time asked the people to worship him and to lift him up to a certain, on a certain pedestal. Moses understood his mission, his job as appointed by God. Jesus, the Christ, is so much better than Moses. It's better to have Jesus. It says in verse 3, "For this man was counted worthy of more glory than Moses, inasmuch as he who had built the house had more honor than the house."
Amen.
Would you go to a man's house? The man has built a house. Don't you know it's more, and it means more to honor the man than the house? Jesus has more honor than Moses. It says, "For every house is built by some man, but he that built all things is God. And Moses verily was faithful in all his house as a servant, for a testimony of those things which were to be spoken after. But Christ as a son over his own house." When we talk about we need to learn how to behave ourselves in the house of God, which is the pillar and ground of the truth, Jesus has his own house. His house is worthy of more honor than Moses. Why? Because Jesus himself is worthy of more honor than Moses. It says, "Whose house are we? If we hold fast the confidence and rejoice of the hope, firm unto the end." So not only is Jesus better than angels, he's also better than Moses. Third point here is our hasten to a close. It says in Hebrews chapter 7, not only is Jesus better than the angels, so get that out of your mind if you are inclined to think that you can worship angels and that's acceptable. Jesus is better than the angels. Jesus is better than Moses. In case you're inclined in your mind this morning that it's okay to worship Moses, Jesus is better than Moses. Third thing this morning, it is better to have Jesus because he is a surety for a better testament. Two testaments that we read about, that we know about in the Bible. The Old Testament had its purpose. It was for to show the coming of the Lord. The New Testament is what we live under. Thank God, and you ought to be thanking God too. Because a lot of things we do now, we would not have survived had we been in the Old Testament.
Man.
A lot of things that we get away with now because of God's mercy and grace, there was swift and immediate punishment for under the Old Testament. Thank God that we have a better testament. Man. Thank God we have Jesus. And I say to you this morning, it's better to have Jesus because he is surety for a better testament. What is surety? Surety is a person who takes responsibility for another's undertaking. Jesus is a guarantor. You ever went somewhere and they say, "You know what? I want to deal with you, but I need you to offer somebody else." Maybe it's in a situation dealing with credit. Amen. Say that score of 212 ain't gonna exactly get you what you want. But if you know somebody with a 750, if you can bring them in and they can act as surety, as a guarantor, well, Jesus, it's better to have him because he is surety for a better testament. Hebrews chapter 7, verse 19. Hebrews chapter 7, verse 19. It says, for the law made nothing perfect, for the bringing in of a better hope did, by the which we draw nigh unto God. And inasmuch as not without an oath, he was made priest. But those priests were made without an oath, but this was an oath by him that said unto him, the Lord swear and will not repent. Thou art a priest forever, after the order of Melchizedek. By so much was Jesus made a surety for a better testament. Because of Jesus, we have a better promise.
Amen.
You know in Revelation 2:10, y'all always should have said, when it says, be thou faithful unto death, I will give thee a crown of life. That's a promise. That promise is predicated upon Jesus the Christ. So to run after another testament, old, improved, different, updated, anything besides the new, is a grave mistake on our part. Jesus bought us a better testament. He took away the old, Colossians 2:14, blotting out the handwriting of ordinance that was against us, contrary to us. I took it out of our way, nailed it to the cross. He's a surety. He's that guarantor for a better testament. Aren't you happy this morning that you have a testament that is guaranteed by Jesus? So when I read, be thou faithful unto death, I will give thee a crown of life. Man, I don't have to sit and toss and turn and worry all night about whether or not that's true. Amen. Look who has put their name. Look who has signed their name. No man. And I pray that you don't trust any man who signed on the line when it comes to your soul. Y'all, so here's the thing about signing for somebody. And young people know this. When someone tells you that you need a cosign and you're trying to purchase something, they say that you are not trusted. They're not trusting you to be able to keep that commitment. They'll say that you are not there yet where you need to be. You need somebody to sign for you. And older people, when someone comes to you about cosigning, parents, let Brother Bishop, they ain't gonna charge you nothing for this. But let me recommend you sit down with a young person and help them to do some financial counseling. And if nothing else, you help them with a down payments. Amen. But when you sign your name, you will say, I'm taking this on. And you talk about relationships going bad. Relationships going bad. And many of us, say amen when you can, have done it. By our own detriment. That's why I say when we know better, we do better. A surety, a guarantee. It's better to have Jesus. Don't allow a man to sign and say, okay, don't worry about what the Bible says. I know what it says because only preachers know. Let's sign your name on your soul salvation. It's not good enough. Jesus is the guarantor, amen, of the New Testament. The fourth thing here, Hebrews chapter 7, drop down to verse 23. Hebrews 7:23. It's better. Y'all got these? It's better because he's better than what? What's number one? Angels? Number two, he's better than who?
Moses.
Number three, he's better than what? Because he's sure for what? A better covenant. A better testament. Number four, we're writing these down. It's better to have Jesus because he is a better priest. Remember in the Old Testament, the way things worked then were completely different than things work under the New Testament. It says in Hebrews chapter 7, verse 23, I'm closing here. And they truly were men priests because they were not suffered to continue by reason of death. But this man, because he continued forever, had an unchangeable priesthood. Talk about Jesus. Wherefore he is able to, he's able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever lived to make intercession for them. Listen to this high priest. Listen to this priest, this example of this priest talking about Jesus. For such an high priest became us who is what? Holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens. No man in any priesthood would ever meet those qualifications.
Amen.
And watch what it says. It says in verse 27, talking about Jesus, who needeth not daily, as those high priests, to offer up sacrifice first for his own sins and then for the people's, for this he did once when he offered up himself. You remember those priests in the Old Testament?
That's right.
The one that's not better than what we have in the New Testament? When those priests offered up sacrifices for the people, guess what they had to do prior to that? They had to get it right for themselves. Now, do I want to put all your eggs in one basket? Do I want to take the chance that I have raised some man up in such high regards that I'm depending solely on this man to get me an audience with God? I'm putting all of my trust and faith in this man that I'm calling a priest, to get me an audience with God. And I'm going to hear God say, well done, thy good and faithful servant. I'm not willing to take that chance. And neither should you. Jesus is better. It's better to have him because he is a better priest. He was such a high priest because he was holy, he was harmless, he was undefiled, separate from sinners, made higher than the heavens, who needed not daily as those high priests to offer up sacrifice, first for his own sins, look at this, and then for the people's, for this he did once when Jesus offered up himself, y'all. How can we not love him? How can we not adore him? How can we not sing praise to him? How can we not sing hallelujah, highest praise to him when he offered up himself?
Amen.
Scarcely for a righteous man will one die. Perhaps for a good man. But God commended his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Romans 5:8, Christ died for us. Man, that does something to me when I think about that. He died for us. No man died for me to save me from my sins. Only Jesus. So yes, he's well qualified to be my priest. Not only my priest, but my high priest. Amen. It says, verse 20, for the law made of men high priests which have infirmity. The law made men high priests who had their own problems. Amen. They were dealing with things. Amen. And it's kind of hard sometimes, church. Man's man at the end of the day. It's hard sometimes for a man to try to deal with somebody else's issues, amen, when they're dealing with their own. It's kind of hard sometimes to stop and give up what you're doing and to save them their own soul as a man sometimes and run off to help somebody else to save theirs. Men have issues. Men are dealing with things day in and day out. I'm simply saying, it's better to have Jesus. Don't put your trust in a man. God has given man certain responsibilities, certain duties, certain roles. But anything above that is reserved for Jesus. It's like the Constitution of the United States. Any powers not specifically ascribed to the federal government is left to the states, amen. Anything that God has not given man to do specifically, everything above that is left for Jesus. Don't put all your hope and trust in a man. Calling man Reverend, calling man Father, all these different titles, talking about the Pope, talking about the Right Reverend, and all these different things. Pastor,
in the work of the Lord, was that Paul was never referred to as Pastor Paul, amen. Peter, never referred to as Elder Peter, amen. Jesus said, y'all brother. Don't put man where man don't need to be, amen. Because it's hard to get him to come down, amen. Hard to get him to come down. So much trouble, amen, when you put him up there. It's better to have Jesus because he's a better priest. It's better to have Jesus number one because he's better than
angels.
It's better to have Jesus because he's better than who?
Moses.
It's better to have Jesus because he was church for what?
Testament.
Better covenant and testament. It's better to have Jesus because he's a better what? Priest. And the last thing is I close. Hebrews chapter 8, verse number 1. It's better to have Jesus because he is established upon better promises. Hebrews chapter 1, excuse me, chapter 8, beginning in verse number 1. Hebrews chapter 8, beginning in verse number 1 as I close. It says, now the things which we have spoken, this is the psalm, this is the Torah. We have such a high priest who is sitting on the right hand of the throne of the majesty in heaven, a minister of the sanctuary, another true tabernacle which the Lord pitched, and not man. Let us together remember, God built the house, amen. Except the Lord build a house, they that build it labor in vain. If this thing don't lead you straight to Jesus, y'all stop back and cautiously consider what's going on. A minister of the sanctuary, the true tabernacle is the Lord pitched and not man. For every high priest is ordained to offer gifts and sacrifices, whereof it is of necessity that this man have somewhat also to offer. You know the priests, they went in there and they offered up the sacrifices. But this man here, he went in and offered something that no one else could offer. It says in verse 4, for if he were on earth, he should not be a priest, seeing that there are priests that offer gifts according to the law, who serve unto the example and shadow of heavenly things, as Moses was in mind of God when he was about to make the tabernacle. For see, said he, that thou make all things according to the pattern showed to you in the mount. But now, talking about Jesus, have he obtained a more excellent ministry? And how much also he is the mediator, we talk about this, of a better covenant, which was established upon better promises. Be thou faithful unto death. That's the one right there, y'all. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Be thou faithful unto death. He said, I'll give you a crown of life. That's a promise, amen. Mm-hmm. That's a promise that will assure us making heaven our home. Mm-hmm. Established upon better promises. Says, for if that first covenant had been faultless, then should no place have been sought for the second. But finding fault with them, he said, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. I'll make a new covenant with the house of Israel, with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant I made with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they continued not in my covenant, and I guarded them not, saith the Lord. And he goes on to talk about this covenant. But it's better to have Jesus because he is better than the angels. It's better this morning to have Jesus because he is better than Moses. It's better to have Jesus because he is our surety for a better covenant. It's better to have Jesus because he is a better priest. And it's better this morning to have Jesus because he was established on better promises.
Amen.
And when Jesus says, come unto me, all you that labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest, I believe that. I believe he promised it. And this world will not go out for come back for something to come instead of which it went out. When Jesus says something, I believe it. When he says, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Two things. He that believes in his baptized shall be saved. He that believes not shall be damned. That's a promise. That is a promise coming from someone. Two different things about God. One thing, he can't swear on anything greater than himself. And the second thing is, it's impossible. He cannot lie. But when he says something, it's solid. When he says something, it's solid. And this morning he said, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, I'll give you rest. I want us to understand that we have to go back to the Bible We have to go back to God. And I hasten the day when all men everywhere will stand up and proclaim, go back to the Bible. Go back to God's word. This is not a game. We're talking about the saving of our souls. But what should it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or will a man be willing to give his change for his soul this morning? What are you willing to give his change this morning for your soul? If you're here this morning, it's better to have Jesus. Whatever you're dealing with this morning, it's better to have Jesus. Solomon tells us, you're going to deal with issues. Are you going to deal with them? With God or with doubt?
Amen.
This morning, it's better to have Jesus. For you this morning, for me this morning, for everybody here this morning, it's better to have Jesus. If you're here this morning, you're not a child of God. You become a child of God by being obedient to the gospel of Christ. The facts of the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Jesus died on the cross, was buried, and rose again the third day. You hear that story? Are you willing to believe it? Are you willing to have a change of mind? Are you willing to confess with your mouth that you believe he's the Son of God? First Corinthians 15, 1 through 4 lays out the facts of the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And then I went to go into the water, bear baptism, have your sins washed away. You see the gifts of the Holy Spirit, you add to the body of Christ, you rise to walk in new life. And then here comes that promise. He says, Revelation 2:10, be thou faithful unto death, and I will give you a crown of life. If he said, someone said, God said it, I believe you, that settles it. God says it, it's already settled.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to believe it. It's already settled. God says, if you're here this morning, you're not a child of God, the invitation is yours. Become a child of God this morning. Be baptized in Christ for remission of your sin. Become a member of the family of God and receive all the spiritual blessings and all those other benefits to come with being a child of God. If you're here this morning, you're not a child of God, we want you to come from seeing how we live. If you're here this morning, you're a child of God, you fall by the wayside for whatever reason. Maybe you forgot just how much better Jesus is. And oh, let me say this. Every 6 or 7 months, once you buy into Jesus, amen. Every 6 or 7 months, I'm not going to wish to see you out there standing in the rain somewhere. Trying to find something better, amen. It's better to have Jesus. How many times? Once and for all. Come as we stand and sing this song to encourage you. Come this morning.